Alhamdulillah, we've covered our Umrah. Now it's time to go into Hajj. Are you guys excited?
Yes.
How many of you have performed Hajj before? 1, 2. Okay, that may be a lot. First time. Hajj everyone first time in all of us. 3, 4, we have a few more. How many of you have done Hajj before? That was my question. Okay, this is 2, 3, 4. Good. For those of you who haven't, when someone says Hajj seminar, what's your mind think? Oh my God, this is going to be so sophisticated, so difficult. How am I ever going to understand it? It's impossible. Nothing is impossible, inshallah. I kid you not, one year I was in Flint, Michigan. I went there for, I have a complicated spinal condition, unfortunately. So I was there at a spinal center for a whole month for therapy. And while I was there, Abdullah showed up. He showed up with the camera and he said, Sheikh, let's do some recordings. I said, what do you want to record? He said, let's do the Hajj pro tips. He was actually visiting his wife. I don't think he was married yet. He went to visit his Tibi Susan in Chicago. And he said, and then he drove up to meet me from Chicago to Flint, 3 hours drive. He said, let's do some recording. I said, what do you want to record? He said, let's do the Hajj pro tips. Have any of you guys seen those videos? Like a minute and a half, quick clips. I really recommend those. You'll benefit a lot from those, inshallah. I think we sat down and maybe like in half an hour we covered all of them. Like 1 hour, we brought them all up together. So that time, I asked Abdullah, I said, Abdullah, when you think of Hajj, do you think it's difficult? He said, it's very difficult. So I said to him, what if I explain the whole Hajj to you in 90 seconds? Will you believe it? He said, no, I won't believe it. I said, turn the camera on. And that was the day we did the video that's uploaded on YouTube called Hajj in 90 seconds. So I'm not going to do it in 90 seconds right now because I had to hold my breath and it was really intimidating when we did it. But I'm going to walk you guys through Hajj very quickly. And this summary of Hajj that I'm about to present to you is very, very, very important. If you understand this summary, inshallah, everything else will be easy. Are you guys ready? Yes. That's why I said in the break, go freshen up, come back with your AD, and we're going to come ready and make it very easy for you, inshallah. So a few things that you need to understand. First thing. In order for you to understand it, you have to understand two things. The time and place. What do you need to understand?
Time
and place. The time is easy. The date of Hajj, the Hajj starts on what date? 8. How do you know that is this? How many of you have, how many of you know, don't say anything, don't blurt it out. How many of you know what day Eid al-Adha is on? What Islamic calendar day is Eid al-Adha on? Raise your hand if you know. Which one is Eid al-Adha? The Hijjah. What day? The 10th. The 10th of the Hijjah is Eid al-Adha wherever you are in the world. Okay? Hajj starts 2 days before and ends 2 days after. Eid al-Adha is which day again? 10th of the Hijjah. It starts 2 days before, which means it starts on one day. What day?
18.
8. Ends 2 days after, which means it ends on what day?
12.
So the total period of Hajj is how many days? 8, 9, 10, 11, and
12.
You understand that's one thing though. One thing though. Now, the second thing I need you to understand is that in Hajj, there are certain cities you need to visit. The Makkah. That's Zaman is then the Makkah. There are certain areas you need to be. In order for you to understand these areas, I need your eyes on me right now. It's very important. We will start in a city called Makkah. East of Makkah, there is a city that touches borders of Makkah. It's called Mina. The way to remember that these two cities touch borders is that the number of letters in this city is exactly the same. 3 and 3. Makkah has how many letters? 3. Next to that, we have another city east of it. It's called what? Mina. 3 letters. Minunia. Now, adjacent to Mina, touching it, is the third city that also starts with an M. Makkah, Mina, this one is?
Muzdalifah.
So if you're drawing, you're going to draw 3 squares. Makkah, Mina, and? Can you walk between these cities? Absolutely. Everyone does it. You can easily walk between them. Depending on what part of Mina and Muzdalifah you're in, you can walk back and forth within 10 minutes. Or it could be an hour, depending on where you are. Most American tents, you guys are all over Dar es Salaam?
Yes.
Anyone that goes in an economy package, Dar es Salaam doesn't offer an economy package. But anyone that goes in an economy package, their tents are actually American tents. All the hides that go from America, our tents are actually 70% of them in Muzdalifah. They're not even in Mina. The American hajis, where are our tents actually located? Like, right at the border of Muzdalifah. You can take one step away in Muzdalifah, take one step away in Mina. And that's not an exaggeration. I literally mean that. That's how close it is to Muzdalifah. The upgraded tents where we are, they're closer to Mecca. So it's on the other side of Mina. So the Mina right here, the upgraded one right here, like on the opposite side. So Mecca. Now, southeast, 7-8 kilometers away, is the last city you need to know. This is the city of, it's not really a city, it's a jungle actually, it's a desert.
Arafah.
It's called Arafah. What is it called?
Arafah.
Arafah. So you have Mecca, Mina, Muzdalifah, and Arafah. Do you guys have that down?
Yes.
Okay. Now, Arafah. We have two ingredients. Huh?
Arafah does not touch.
It doesn't touch anything, it's far away. Arafah is far, it's like 7-8 kilometers away. If you walk on foot, it might take you a few hours to get there. People do walk. A lot of people walk, actually. It's a few-hour walk. I won't recommend anyone do it from America, anyway, from our groups. I'm not sure if it's a healthy or smart idea. Now that you have the two ingredients, the time and the place, now we're going to mix the two. This is where it's important. Hajj starts on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. Your starting point is city number one, Mecca. Okay? After Fajr Salah on the 8th, you leave and you arrive in a city that's touching next door. What is the city called? So the 8th of the Hijjah, first day, you are in your city. You're going to be here for 24 hours. How many hours?
24 hours.
Meaning the whole of the 8th of the Hijjah, you're going to be here. Technically speaking, the way we say it is, you will pray Fajr on the 8th of the Hijjah in Mecca, and the next 5 Salah you'll be there in Mina. Fajr Salah, yes, I'll walk you through this. I'll explain it all. The Fajr of the 8th of the Hijjah, where are you going to pray? Mecca. Arrive in Mina and pray how many Salah here? Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr. You're going to pray 5 Salah here. Day 1 is done. What day are we on now?
Day 2.
9. Day 2. This is the day before Eid. The day before Eid. This day is called Yom Arafah. What is this day called?
Yom Arafah.
What we're going to do on this day is that instead of going to the next city, which is? We're going to skip that. And we're going to go all the way around to the far away city. This little jungle desert area. What is it called?
Arafah.
We will arrive there and stay there for the day hours, the daylight hours of day number 2. When does daylight end?
Maghrib.
So we will be there until?
Maghrib.
When we're done with, so this is Mecca, Mina, Muzdalifah, Arafah. We've spent the day hours here. Now it's time to come back. When we're coming back after Maghrib, we're going to stop over in Muzdalifah. Where are we going to stop? And we're going to stay here until sunrise. So day 2, half of the day is in Arafah, and the night is in? Muzdalifah. Are you guys with me so far?
Yeah.
So day 1, where did you spend it? Mina. Day 2, it was divided in half. Half of the day was in?
Arafah.
Half of the night is in? You're going to be in Muzdalifah until when?
Fajr.
After Fajr Salah, you're never going to visit these two cities ever again. Not on this trip anymore. You have 3 days left for Hajj. You will come back to Mina, and you will spend all 3 days here, your Hajj is over. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
Let's start again. What day do we start?
8 days.
Where are we going to go to Fajr?
Mecca.
And then come to?
Mina.
How many salah are you here for?
5.
Then we go to?
5.
How many salah did we read there?
3.
2. 2. The daylight salah. How many salah did we read during the day hours? Dhuhr Asr. At Ghurub, Maghrib time, we won't pray there. We're not going to pray there. We're going to leave and come to Muzdalifah and pray the two night prayers, actually all three night prayers. Maghrib and Isha together, and then Fajr as well. After sunrise, we come to?
Mina.
How many days left?
3 days.
Today is the day of Eid. We arrive here on the 10th of the Hijjah. Stay for the 11th. Stay for the 12th. Hajj is done. Your Hajj is done. If you understand that, now what I'm going to do is go over this one more time, and I'm going to add in what you need to do each day. If I covered this last time, this last round, your Hajj, you already completed. But we have to walk through this whole procedure. How many more times? One more time. And this time I'm going to tell you what needs to be done each day. You know where to be, you know when to be, now it's about what to do. Okay? Are you guys with me? Here we go. Let's start again. What day do we start our Hajj?
Eight.
We're going to pray Fajr Salah in Makkah. Come to Mina. We will pray how many Salah there?
Five.
Now, during this day, the first day of Mina, there is nothing required to do. The scholars will say rest, do some dhikr, spend some time doing dua, read some Quran. But there's no hard lifting that needs to be done on this day. The hard lifting that has to be, the hard lifting is tomorrow in Arafah. So before you go to Arafah, one day before, you kind of like detox, relax out, take it easy. Now, the next morning, you're going to arrive in Arafah. When you arrive in Arafah, you leave after Fajr Salah on the 9th. Remember we said 5 prayers in Mina? So what day is it now? The 9th, you've got Fajr Salah here, you go to Arafah. Depending on when you arrive in Arafah, let's say you left at 6 a.m., you get there at 7 a.m. if you went on a bus. Or you leave at 7 a.m. and you walk and you get there at 12 p.m. When you get to Arafah, you can do whatever you want to until Dhuhr time starts. So let's say you arrive there at 7 a.m. and Dhuhr is at 12:30, so you have 5.5 hours in the middle. What can you do during those 5.5 hours? Go to sleep. It's a very smart idea. Get some rest. Go to sleep, eat, walk around, shower, whatever you want to do. That's not the time for Ibadah, actually. There's no prescribed time. Because the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba, they spent that time walking. They didn't come on a bus. They were covering all those miles in the heat, so they slowly made their time, they made themselves there around the Zalal time. But we're going to get there faster. So you arrive in Arafah until Dhuhr time, you're free. Once Dhuhr time starts, what happens now? Your clock starts. You have until Maghrib to do whatever the law you want. Generally speaking, the period that you will spend in Arafah that counts as a part of your wukuf, as a part of your Hajj, is around 6 hours. What is it?
6 hours.
So you need to, before you come to Arafah, make a game plan of how to keep yourself busy for 6 hours. You have to make that game plan. Hour number one, I'm going to read Quran. Hour number two, I'll make some dua. Hour number three, I'll do some dhikr. Then I'll make some more Quran. You create your own game plan. You have to tell yourself, if I walk into Arafah without a 6-hour game plan, there is no point going to Hajj. You have to create a strong, solid, 6-hour game plan. What do I need to do? Someone said, my friends have given me a lot of du'as, what should I make them? You'll have a 6-hour window. You make du'as then. Make some du'a now, make some du'a here, stand outside and make du'a, come back inside and make du'a, stand up, sit down. You keep yourself busy, but you need to have a very strong game plan for how many hours?
6 hours.
6 hours. When Maghrib hits in, you're done. Okay? You arrived in Arafah earlier that day, Dhuhr time kicked in, the Imam will lead you in Dhuhr and Asr together, he will also deliver a khutbah, which will then transition onto your wukuf. Maghrib Salah will come in, your ibadah ends. When Maghrib Salah comes in, now where do you need to go? Muzdalifah. You arrive there, when you come to Muzdalifah, you go pray your Maghrib and Isha together. Okay. When you pray your Maghrib and Isha together in Muzdalifah, after you've prayed it, there are some things that need to be done. Number one, ideally this is where you're going to collect your stones that you're going to need for the next 3 days. We're going to be stoning you for the next 3 days. Okay? You need some stones for these days. How many stones do you need?
17.
21, 21, 7, 49. You need 49 stones minimum. How many? 49 stones minimum. And if you want, you can have 7. 49 or 70. Why am I saying these numbers? I'll explain to you. But for now, what are the two numbers? 49 or 707. Those are the two numbers you have to remember. You collect your stones from there, get some sleep, wake up, do some Tahajjud Salah. Basically, in Muzdalifah, you can do whatever you want until Fajr time starts. When Fajr time starts, this is when the actual wuquf starts. You know how I said in Arafah, if you get to another early, it doesn't really matter? Remember how I said that to you? When does the actual time start? At Zawah, at Fajr time. For Muzdalifah, the actual meaningful time starts when? At Fajr. This is when you need to be there. Now there's a difference between, and I'm going to share both of them here. We all know the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did his wuquf after Fajr Salah. What do we know? Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he did his wuquf, meaning he did the actual prayer in Dua in Muzdalifah when? After Fajr. But he left there before sunrise. So after Fajr, that kind of like 45 minutes, 1 hour is when you do your Dua, wuquf, whatever you want to do. But before sunrise, what did the Prophet do? He moved on to the next destination, which is going to be Mina. So we know that's the sunnah. But the question is, what part is obligatory? That's the big question. Some scholars say it's mandatory to be there after Fajr, which is the Hanafi position, because we say that's when the Prophet was there. So what do we say? It's mandatory to be there after Fajr. Other scholars, they say it's mandatory to be there any time after half of the night passes, after this from late. After half of the night passes by. So after 1 a.m. you need to be there for a little bit, for example. After 2 a.m. you need to be there for a little bit, for example. How do you know when half of the night passes by? It's simple. Let's say, for example, Maghrib is at 6 p.m., Fajr is at 6 a.m. It's 12 hours, divide 12 by 2, that gives you how much? 6. So at 6 hours from the time Maghrib starts, that means half of the night has passed by. You guys understand? How do you calculate this from late half of the night has passed by? You find out the total time period between Maghrib and Fajr. You divide that by 2, add those hours to the Maghrib time and what do you have? This from late. So the Shafi'i and other Fuqaha and the Hanbali scholars, they say it's mandatory to be in Muzdalifah until this from late. After this from late, after half of the night, you can start going. And fortunate or unfortunate, whichever way you'd like to look at it, most people start leaving after this from leaving. If there's a necessity, if there's a need to leave, go ahead. But remember this, where is God who has to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? There's no difference of opinion that when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam performed his Hajj, where was he after Fajr Salah al-Day? He was in Islam. So I usually recommend people don't cut corners and don't leave. Stay there to Fajr, do your Dua after Fajr, and then move on. Women are not mandated to stay in Muzdalifah. They can skip. The Prophet gave permission to the women that if you want to move on from Mina, go ahead. And the elderly as well, the Prophet gave him permission that if you want to move on, go ahead. But people that are young, that don't need to move ahead, don't move ahead, stay in Muzdalifah, spend the night here. Muzdalifah, interestingly, has no tent there. It's the only place where there are no accommodations at all, except for without a salah. And I'm not saying this to 2,000 more. Honestly, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to state the fact. It's the only group from the USA that goes that I'm aware of that actually provides carpeting in Muzdalifah. I have never seen that before in my life. Last year was the first time I went to Dar es Salaam. When I came there and I came to Muzdalifah, I was like, so am I here? Why is there carpeting there? There's supposed to be stone, there's supposed to be sand, there's supposed to be lying down in dirt. And they said, you know, this is the Iqbal we do. They had like a nice food buffet there and drinks. And I was like, oh my goodness. I've never been hyped on this before. So alhamdulillah, you will enjoy that luxury as well. Bismillah. But if it rains, you're on your own. If it rains in Muzdalifah, what do? You sit down, soak it in. Wait till Fajr when the sun comes out, you'll dry it in 45 minutes. But there's nothing you can do at that point. Because if you try to run, you'll get caught in the stampede. That happened when it started raining. I said to everyone, guys, don't go anywhere. Just sit right here, let it rain, let it get cold. After Fajr Salah, 45 minutes later, I guarantee you what's going to happen. We're going to be dry. Our houses are different colors from all the contamination, but it'll be dry, inshallah. Muzdalifah is then. What day are we on now? The third day of Hajj. We arrive in Mina. This day is the most, I don't want to use the word difficult, I don't want to use the word sophisticated, It's the more busy day of Hajj. What am I going to call it?
Busy.
It's the busiest day of Hajj. What day is it? Because so far, everything I told you was make dua, make dua, make dua. Yes or no? Now on this day, you actually have to do certain things. What are the things you need to do? Ideally, the sequence is this. You stone. Number two, you sacrifice an animal. Number three, you cut your hair. Number four, you go to Mecca, you go to Mecca to perform an more or less an Umrah, but Allah is saying. So how many things do you need to do on this day? What's the first thing? Stoning. Second thing?
Sacrifice.
Third thing? Shaving your hair. And number four? Go to Mecca for Ibadat Allah Ziyarah and Sa'il al-Qadr. These are the four things that need to be done. I'm going to go with each one and provide some detail. Are you guys ready?
Yes.
Number one. What was number one? First, let's discuss the timing of the stone. On this day, you can stone any time after sunrise until Fajr the next day. What did I say? What is the window that you have to stone? From sunrise, inshallah, duha, all the way until when? The Fajr Salah the next day. So you have around almost 24 hours, minus a little bit, okay? So you have from sunrise until then. That's the first thing. The second thing, on this day, there are three pillars of there are three pillars there. On day one, you only stone one pillar. You don't stone all three. Day two and day three, you stone all three. So on day one, how many pillars are you stoning?
One.
Each time you stone a pillar, regardless of which day it is, you always throw seven pebbles. Now do the math. If you're stoning one pillar day one, day two and day three pillars and three pillars, how many pebbles do you need? 49. Because if you're stoning three pillars and each one gets seven pebbles, how many is that? 21. 21 and 21 is? 42. 42 and day one, you're only stoning one pillar, how many is that? Listen, let me do it again for you guys. You're stoning 3 days. Day three, you're stoning three pillars. Each pillar gets seven stones. How many stones is that?
21.
Day two, you're stoning three pillars, seven pebbles each stone. How many stones is that?
21.
21 is? 42. Day one, you're only stoning one pillar, seven stones. How many is that?
Seven.
Seven plus 42 is?
49.
Alhamdulillah. We have the numbers wrong. It's 49 stones that you need. Now, you know how I said Hajj is 5 days? You can optionally stone one more day, which will make your Hajj 6 days. It's an option, you don't have to do it. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did it. If you do stone that extra day, you're going to stone three more pillars. Add 21 stones to 49, how much does that become?
Seven.
Remember I told you two numbers? I said either 49 stones or 70. If you're going to do the extra day of Hajj, the Prophet did do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it'll be 7. So come back to day 1, the 10th of the Hijjah, which is now the first day of the 3 days of Mina. The first thing I want to do is stone one pillar. It's the big pillar. It's called the big pillar. You'll see it on there, huh? Yeah, Aqaba Kubra. It's called Aqaba because that's the valley of Aqaba, and Kubra means the biggest one. Okay? It's the big pillar, it's a little bit of stone pillars. When you're stoning, you do not need to be in the state of wudu. It is recommended to stone with the right hand. The sunnah method of stoning is that you hold the pebble between your index finger and your thumb, and you stone like this. Like this. Okay? Some narration mentioned that you put the pebble on the nail of the thumb and you flick it like that. I'm coming to that. So this is how you stone. With each stone, you will say, Bismillah Allahu Akbar. What are you going to say?
Bismillah
Allahu Akbar. If you forget to say Bismillah Allahu Akbar, it's okay. It does not affect your stone. But you have to throw each of the seven stones individually. You can't take seven stones and throw them at once. If you throw seven stones at once, that counts as how many stones?
One.
Okay? Because the actual act, rami, is what's required. You have to throw seven stones individually. Each stone needs to fall within the circle around the pillar. Even if it doesn't hit the pillar, it's okay. But if there's a circle around it, you'll see this little wall, it needs to, what did I say? Fall inside there. As long as it falls in there, you're good. Let's recap. You don't need wudu from sunrise until when?
Next
day, Fajr, anytime you want. You can go later in the night, you can go earlier in the day. Some scholars say this is mustahab time, not any time. All of that, according to the majority of the scholars, doesn't apply to you. And the reason is because a large amount of people. Whenever you can go, say bismillah and go. Seven stones and a big pillar. After you're done stoning, we're done with item number one. What's item number two?
Sacrifice
to an animal. This sacrifice of an animal is called dam shukr, meaning you are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a sacrifice of thanking Allah. This is not Eid al-Adha sacrifice, even though it's the same day. Even though it's the same day, it's not Eid al-Adha sacrifice. What is the sacrifice? Dam shukr, you're thanking Allah. Thanking Allah for what? This sacrifice is only for someone who does an umrah before the Hajj. If you did not do an umrah before the Hajj, you don't have to do a sacrifice. What did I say? If you do an umrah before Hajj, you will need to do the sacrifice because you're thanking Allah that you use one journey for two things, umrah and Hajj, dam shukr. But if you do not do an umrah before the Hajj, let's say you arrive and you stay in the haram, you just do Hajj, you go back home, then there is no sacrifice. Are you guys with me? Second thing is that, where will you get the sacrifice done? Allah salam will do for you. Just tell them that we need the sacrifice, they'll take care of it. Okay. Number three, what's the third thing? Shaving the head. I already talked about this. You guys know the procedure. Same procedure. Trimming and shaving for men, women only have an option of trimming, split your hair to 3, 1 inch in the bottom. We're done with that?
Yeah.
Now the fourth thing. What's the fourth thing?
Tawaf.
Inside. If you've already cut your hair by now, what does that mean?
Done with the
count. You're not in the
haram.
If you already cut your hair, what does that mean? So when you're not in the haram, when you go for the tawaf, you don't need to uncover your right shoulder. Because you're not in the haram. You need to walk a little fastly for men. Just like those Ramadan. Remember that Ramadan tawaf we talked about? That Ramadan? Walking fast, quicker for 3 rounds. You need to do that. Finish off your 7 rounds. Go to Safa Marwa. Do the 7 rounds there. You are done. Are you guys with me? It's a standard 7 rounds tawaf, 7 rounds Safa Marwa. Now, for the sisters, should I get down or should I get down? I'll do it in a moment. Hold your question, but I have to finish up all my house. I'll come back to the sisters' issue in a moment. Just keep that in mind. I'll come back for in a moment. So now we're moving to day number four. Day number four. All you have to do on this day is stone the 3 pillars, 7 pebbles each. 7 pebbles each pillar. Okay? You can stone any time once the Dhuhr time starts until Fajr the next day. Day one, when did the time you start? Dhuha, sunrise. Day two and three, when did the time start? Dhuhr, at Zawa. At Dhuhr time, you can go and stone any time until Fajr the next day. But there's one added point here. This day, you won't only stone the big pillar, you'll stone the middle and small one too. You'll start with the small one, go to the middle one, and with the big one. The Prophet ﷺ, after stoning the small and middle one, would stand and make dua for it. Would face the qibla and make dua for it. After only the small and middle one, he never made dua after the big one. So on day one, did you make any dua? Because which one did you stone? The big one. On day two, you're going to stone 3 pillars. After you stole the small one, what did he do?
Dua.
Made dua. Stole the middle one, then what did he do?
Dua.
After the third one? No dua. Are you guys with me? That's the 7 pillars, 7 pebbles, right hand, index finger, thumb, you're throwing it, you're stoning. 7 pebbles, that's done. Now, once that's done, day two is also done. Nothing else needs to be done on this day. What day are we on now? Day three, which is now the last day of Hajj. I call it day three because it's the 3 days in Mina. Otherwise, you're on the 5th day of Hajj, your last day of Hajj, which is the 12th of the Hijjah. You can stone starting what time? Dhuhr, Zawal. Go all the way until?
Fajr
the next day. How many stones are we going to stone this day? 21. Starting with which pillar? Small one after that? Middle pillar? Third pillar? Hajj Mubarak. Your Hajj is done. You guys understand that? For those of you who came in thinking that Hajj is going to be very confusing, I told you I was going to explain it. Do you guys feel uncomfortable now with the explanation of how Hajj works? I'll take all the questions. I'll give you guys time. Trust me, I won't cheat you on anything, inshallah. Because let me explain my thoughts in the chain that I need to explain it. Okay. I have to do a revision, and there's one point I need to explain, then I'll take your questions, inshallah. I have to first go through a revision. Since it's in your mind here, what day does Hajj start?
Eight.
Where are we starting?
Mecca.
We pray Fajr Salah there, enter into a haram. Remember I told you guys, if you're all the way in the haram, where do you enter into a haram from? Your home, your hotel. Enter from your hotel, you're in the haram. Where are we going now? How many salah there?
Five.
What are we doing while we're there?
Rest.
So think of whatever you want. Day one is up. What day are you on now?
Two.
Where are we going?
Arafah.
What time does the Arafah period actually start? Until? How many prayers are we going to pray here?
Two.
What are they?
Jama'ah.
According to majority of the scholars, there's Jama'ah. According to some Hanafi scholars, there's no Jama'ah. Means you pray Dhuhr in its own time, Asr in its own time. If you're not praying behind the Imam of Hajj, some Hanafi scholars put this condition. Unless you're praying behind the Imam of Hajj, you separate your prayers, otherwise you pray them together. My advice as a Hanafi student of knowledge and someone who's taught behind the fiqh is that follow whatever your intent is doing. If you have an imam who's combining the prayers, what should you do? Follow. There's a lot of virtue in uniting the ummah. You understand? Don't play fiqh wars in haram. I mean, when you're on haram. And if someone wants to pray this salah separately, leave them alone. What did I say? Let them do what they want. If they're following a madhab, they're following an opinion. As a Hanafi student of knowledge, I don't feel that the Hanafi fatwa on this issue is strong. I don't think that I am strong, but nonetheless, my opinion doesn't matter. If that's the opinion you've always followed, follow it. Guys, don't put anything on the guilt trip. What are you doing until London in this period? Now, once London hits it, where are we going? What do we do when we're right there? London, Isha, and then? How many fellows? 49 or 7. 49 or 7. Now remember one thing, I forgot to mention this. The size of the kettle should be the size of the chickpea. You don't want to get bricks. Size of the chickpea, that's it. Collect them and keep them with you, you're good to go. Pray the Hajj that night. Fajr Salah after Fajr is when the actual roof is. Makes dua, dhikr. After you're done here, before sunrise, before duha, before Ishraq, where are you going to come? Mina. When you come to Mina, there are four things you need to do. Just remember the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He was taking his son to sacrifice him. Shaitan came. What's the first thing he did? He stoned him. Then he sacrificed his son. We exited the haram by cutting our hair, and then you go for it the walking son. So what's the first thing you're going to do on this day? Stone. Second thing? Sacrifice. Third thing? Hair. Fourth thing? After you've done these three things, now you're going to go to Makkah. Makkah is the next city over. So you have to do three things in Mina. One thing in Makkah. You don't have to do it in the middle. You can cut your hair in Makkah too. But basically, that's kind of like the. I'll take it up here. So, first thing, stone. Second thing, sacrifice. Then, shave or trim. And third, fourth thing,
Allah.
How many pillars are we stoning this day? One. How many pebbles?
Seven.
Is it a dua after the stoning?
No.
Because it's a big pillar. What time does it start?
After
sunrise. Until when? Until Fajr Salah. Now, sacrificing an animal. If you're doing a Hajj that has what before? Umrah, you need to sacrifice. Otherwise, no sacrifice. If you want the sacrifice, until the Prophet Salah will take care of it. Don't worry about that. You don't have to worry about it. It'll happen until. Then cut your hair. We already talked about cutting your hair. Once this is done, now we're going to do your tawaf. This tawaf, by the way, is tawaf. If you don't do this tawaf, your Hajj doesn't come. If you don't, that's why this salaf is very important to discuss with the sisters. If you don't do this salaf, what happens? You have to do it. You have to do this salaf. You come back to Makkah, you perform this salaf, you perform the sa'i. It's just like doing the umrah the salaf is. The only difference is this time you're probably not going to be in your ihram. So you won't cover your right shoulder. Everything else is exactly the same. For men, you walk fast in the first 3 rounds, 2 rak'ah, zamzam, muntazam, mudasafa Allah, walk back and forth. It's the exact same thing, minus what? The right shoulder is pulled up. There's no uncovering of the right shoulder. Once this is done, day three is done. Now we're entering into day four. Day four, what do we need to do?
Stone.
How many till it is?
Three.
When does the time start? Zawal, Bohat, until? Fajr. You start with which pillar? After that, you make? Then? And then? Then you go to the third pillar? No dua. You're done? Which day are we at now?
Fourth.
The fifth. Fourth is the fifth day, around the fifth day. We just said we've stoned 3 pillars, right? It has to be the fourth day. Around the fifth day, how many pillars are we stoning? Starting with? Small one, then? Middle one? And then the big one? No dua. After that, your hajj is complete. You guys have that so far? Now that you have this, there's one last little adjustment I need to make. Actually, one more thing. Before you leave Makkah, you need to do something called tawaf al-wada. Before you leave Makkah, you need to do something called... It's just a standard tawaf. It's 7 rounds followed by 2 rak'ah. You can do it in your own clothes. Anytime before you leave Makkah, just do 7 rounds and pray 2 rak'ah after it, tawaf al-wada.
No safa marwa.
It's just standard tawaf al-wada. You need to be in a state of wudu, 7 rounds, 2 rak'ah, you're done. Tawaf al-wada. The last thing is this. This is the most important part. For the sisters. It's this tawaf we need to do on day 3 of Hajj. One of the conditions of tawaf is that it must be done in the state of tahara. You guys understand that? If a lady is in her menstruation, what's the problem? Go ahead, guys. What's the problem? She can't do it. Why not? Because one of the conditions of tawaf is purity. To be in the state of purity, tahara, and she's in menstruation, which is not in the state of purity. So what does she do now? Now listen to me here. The first thing is this. If you have a good idea that those are the days of your menstruation, book a package that allows you to stay in Makkah after Hajj. What's the first thing I said? If you know those are your days of menstruation, what's the first thing you need to do? Find the Hajj package that goes to Medina first, Hajj, and then stays in Makkah. That's what you need to do ideally. So if there is a little up or down, in case you need extra days, after Hajj you're going to stay in Medina for another 3-4 days, your schedule will clear up, you can do your tawaf. You guys understand? First scenario, listen carefully, I'll walk you through all the scenarios. You have to pay attention. If you don't pay attention, you're going to ask questions. What was the first thing I said to you? Well, no, what's the first thing I said to you? Choose a package that allows, not in 60 longer, I said choose a package that allows you to stay in Makkah after the days of Hajj. What was the first thing? If you know, what should you do? That allows you to stay in Makkah after the days of Hajj. Number two, if that's not possible, and your days of Hajj are here, and you're going to be leaving Makkah before you can finish your Hajj off, you can't leave Makkah without performing that. If you leave Makkah, regardless of whatever happens, without doing that tawaf, your Hajj doesn't count. You have to come back in it. And it's even more difficult than that. Not only that, but until you don't come back, you cannot be intimate with your spouse. If you come back 2 years later, for those 2 years, what happens? What did I say? You cannot be intimate with your spouse. Okay? I can explain, if someone has questions, I can explain it later. There are hadith regarding all this, and there are rulings regarding all this. I'm really summarizing the last thing. So you need to do your tawaf. What do you do? If you can find a way to stay extra, that's what you need to do. This is the opinion of Imam Ahmad al-Hanbal al-Fuqaha. They say that she has no other option but to. She has to stay extra. She needs to reschedule your ticket or do whatever it is that needs to happen, but you need to stay to the tawaf. Now, other fuqaha, what they say is that what she'll do is do tawaf in the state of hajj, which is not ideal at all. It's actually not a good situation. But you have to consider the options. What are the options? Can you delay your ticket? Either yes or no. If you can delay your ticket and Bob's your uncle, you're done. If you can't delay your ticket, now what's your option? Either you leave without doing it, which means what? You have to come back. And until you don't come back, you cannot be intimate with your spouse. Or you do it and then you leave. If you do it in the state of faith, what's the ruling? There are three opinions on the issue. The Hanafi scholars have the strictest opinion. They say if a lady does tawaf in the state of Hayy, she will have to sacrifice a budna. What's the word I used?
Budna.
You know how you asked about what are different types of penalties? This is the only answer I'm giving you. A budna is a penalty that's equivalent to slaughter. That means sacrificing a camel, which is around a $3,000 penalty. What are the Hanafi scholars saying?
Camel.
You have to sacrifice a camel or a cow, big animal. Which could be how much? It could be around, it could be 2,000, 3,000, I'm not sure if it's that market over there. But I remember when you're checking, it was between 2,000 to 3,000. It's a big penalty. The other scholars, they say that it won't be a budna, it'll be a dam. It'll be a normal penalty. A normal penalty means you sacrifice a sheep. And that's roughly around $130, $120. This is the opinion that I have, that give a sheep. Give a $120 sacrifice and be clear. The third group of scholars, they say that there's no penalty at all. Where that does sound very appealing, I would always recommend to give some sort of penalty. It's not because you committed a crime, but because when you do something that's not recommended in an ibadah, that creates a deficiency. And that deficiency needs to be filled in. That's why at the end of our salah, if you miss a wajib, you need to do something to some. You guys understand that? You create a deficiency. Regardless of whether that was intent or not, whether it was intentional or not, you maybe didn't even mean to do it, but you did it. Do you have to do sadaqah al-sahw? You need to do sadaqah al-sahw. There needs to be some sort of a penalty. So my advice is, if you have no other option, you need to do your tawaf instead of hayy. That's what it all boils down to. Then the best option then is do the tawaf, give the penalty, and the rest is going to be very easy. One last thing. I said to you guys, that the tawaf should be done on what day? The tawaf li fada, tawaf li sa'i, what day does it need to be done on?
Day 3.
Day 3. Right? Day 3 of Hajj. The truth is that this tawaf can be done any time after the fajr of day 3, after sunrise of day 3. What did I say? No, not even sunrise, fajr. Any time after the fajr of day 3, and you can delay it all the way to the maghrib of day 5. What did I say? All the way to the maghrib of day 5. So let's say day 3 of Hajj, you're on Hayy, but you know day 4 you're going to be done. That's good for you. Just delay the salat and sa'ijun the next day. No penalty at all. Even the men, by the way, if there's too much crowding on day 1, you can delay it to day 2. You can also delay it to day 3. But for men, you must get it done by the maghrib of day 3. Otherwise, there's going to be a penalty for the day. For women, you are allowed to delay it past day 3 as well if you are in Hayy. Because of your own restrictions, you can delay it past day 3 and do whatever you wish if you're in Hayy. Question at the end.
Day 3 of Mina.
Day 3 of Mina, yes. The last day.
Day 5
of Hajj. Okay. Day 3 means, for me, means day 3 of Mina, which means day 5 of Hajj. Okay. So it starts on day 3 after Fajr and must be done by when?
Before
Maghrib on day 5. Now let's say there's a lady who's pure on day 3 of Hajj. Fajr time comes in, she's pure. And she knows this is the day my Hajj is going to start. She can skip everything that day and go straight to Makkah and Mu'awwidh. What did I say?
Skip
the other. She can skip everything, go straight to Makkah and Mu'awwidh, and come back and do the rest of the stuff. Her husband can accompany her too. So you can skip everything, go straight to Makkah, do your tawaf, do your sa'i. Once you're done there, then come back, stone, sacrifice, and touch your hand. Do you guys understand that? Okay. Now that we've covered this, that more or less summarizes our Hajj.
Repeat that last one.
The last thing I said? If a lady knows that she is pure on day 3 of Hajj, she just finished Muzdalifah, she just prayed herself. She knows sometime today my Hajj is going to start. So what are the two options? Option number one is stone, slaughter, cut your hair, and then go to Makkah. But that delay could take 6-7 hours. That could take six, the whole process could easily take 6-7 hours. If I follow this process of 6-7 hours, my Hajj will come most likely. So what she'll do is that she'll skip doing these three things first. She'll go to Makkah first. Do her tawaf and sa'i, then come back and do these three things before Fajr salah. Are you guys with me?
Yes.
So that's the option that she has. Now, I'm assuming the back might say my time's over. So before my time is over, I'm going to ask you guys, what says? It says, wrap up in 5 minutes. How long is that? Time, man. So, that's that, bro.
That's not.
Okay, I'm going to ask you guys to do one thing. Everyone, pair up with the person next to you and go through the whole procedure. Questions asked. Pair up with the person next to you. Everyone, grab the person next to you. I'm going to give you 3 minutes. You will cover the whole. You can pair up in twos and threes. I don't know. Pair up in twos and threes, however you want. Everyone needs to be with someone and go through the whole procedure.